But today, our first speaker is a guy by the name of Peter Brewer. Now, Peter is a well-known gentleman, person. There he is. Oh, he's a big bloke too. He's been around, is well-known in Brisbane. Peter is a speaker, educator, digital footprint strategist on a mission, some say a crusade, to ensure that smart businesses and smart business people treat the new digital world with the respect that it deserves. And I think that is a really, really, really strong statement that needs to be taken on its merits. Peter is a former real estate agent, so he's not talking theory here. Been a real estate agent for 30 years and now speaks across Australia, New Zealand and in the United States on technology and digital media in the real estate industry. Could you please welcome Peter Brewer?
I think we mic'd up. Can we hear me down the back okay? Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Can we have a good morning, everyone?
Morning.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Hey, this is like a real who's who of Australasian real estate royalty, isn't it? Narelle Gill, were you Narelle? I saw you before. Alan Lucas, Colin Jeffrey, Graham Bickley. This is pretty cool to be in front of you people, Ross Bischoff. So thanks, Michael, for the opportunity of being here today. Mate, of all the introductions I've had, that's certainly the most recent. I want to thank you for it. We're going to go through a bit of stuff today. We've got about 3 hours worth of material to go through in about 55 minutes. So I talk really fast, so I apologise for that. If I'm going too fast that you can't understand, the rules are really simple. Hand in the air and say, slow down, fat man. Is that okay? Is that fair? Also, we're going to be talking about social media, Web 2.0, the new world. And for me, it's a conversation. And so if there's a stage in the presentation where you're going too fast, or I disagree, or I don't understand, please put your hand in the air as well. Is that okay? Because you paid money to be here, I'd like to think you're going to get some value out of what we're talking about. And what are we talking about? We're going to talk a bit about some trends, some things that are happening, a trend that I call socialnomics, which is, of course, social media, technology, and the new economy. We're going to talk a bit about digital warfare. So for me, this new world is absolute digital warfare. And it's tough for you guys, because I've been in the shoes that you guys have been in, that we've got to list, sell, prospect, all that other stuff, and then someone brings in the internet and social media, and we think, how the hell do we fit all that stuff in, Graham Bickley? Is that true? Where are you, Graham? So how do you fit all this stuff in? So we're going to talk about that digital warfare, because I believe that we really need to focus seriously on this stuff. I'm going to talk a little bit about what I call social not working, because lots of us talk about social networking, but what about social not working? They say Facebook's a great place to spend 30 minutes when you've got 6 hours to spare, or vice versa, I'm sorry. So we're going to talk about some of those sorts of things. We're going to talk a little about, what do we got happening here? We're going to talk about some of the things that have changed in life. Who would have thought that 5 years ago, cigarette packets in Australia had photos of cancerous toes and spleens on them, rather than the Marlboro man riding it on his horse? Is that a change? Yeah? Who would have thought we looked at something like Kodak? Where are we? Our clicker's not going too well, Mr. Clicker Man. Wait, we get up here. Who would have thought that something like Flight Centre, 10 years ago, that Flight Centre shares are now trading at around $42 a share? Who would have thought that's the case, that around 40% of Australia's travellers booked online 10 years ago? Would we have thought that was the case? Don't think so. Well, if you looked at a company like Kodak, 130 years of tradition, the way that we took photos would just go out the door. Is that a change that we didn't expect? Who thought that was like, wow, that's crazy that happened? Yeah? Can I get a nod? Who would have thought, again, Mr. Clicker, what are we doing here? Who would have thought the telephone was almost obsolete? Certainly in terms of the dial-up telephone's gone. Some of us use these things, where are we? Some of us use these mobile devices. In fact, some people even make telephone calls with the damn things these days. True? I was at a function, in fact it was here, it was about 15 years ago, and there was a lady called Lawn Zilfish, and I don't know whether Lawn's still in business these days, but she was a top performing agent with one of the real estate franchise groups. And it was an awards breakfast, and she said, Pete, come and look at my new Celica, similar to that one. And it was a two-door car, and I said, Lawn, what are you doing? How are you going to show clients houses in a two-door car? Roscoe, who remembers the days when, for us, showing property was putting buyers in the car till they buy or die? Was that it? I mean, I remember showing people properties for 9 days, just keep showing them stock. Is that what happens now? Who gets the luxury of putting people in the car and building relationships for 2 or 3 days, showing endless properties? Does that happen, by the way? No, the rules have changed, so things have changed. Who would have thought this 10 years ago? Roscoe? Who would have thought, you probably can't see the slide. Who would have thought that 10 years later, or today, you'd be paying $3,665 for an ad on realestate.com.au? How are you feeling about that, by the way? What are you doing about it, by the way? Seriously, what are you doing about it? How are you doing it? I've got to tell you, based on what I'm seeing, when they can go to the market and say 3665, you don't get much of a choice. I don't know that you are killing it. But the challenge is, I'd love you to. One of the things that frustrates the living hell out of me as a former real estate agent is the fact that our industry is getting ripped by people when we should be looking after the coin ourselves, quite honestly. And my apologies to those sponsors that you've got here. We're all entitled to a fair share of the buck, but to be paying that sort of money, for me, is just crazy. It's the one constant we know. Sorry?
They just reduced the bar
tab. The one constant we know is change. And so for me, the question for you guys is, in a world of change, what's your point of difference? Are we doing stuff the way that we've always done stuff in the past? I was in a room full of real estate agents in Washington 2 weeks ago, 150 agents, and I said, if I had Coldwell Banker coming in at 1 o'clock today to appraise my home and talk about marketing it, and I had you coming at 2 o'clock today, that's not a sign, by the way, and I had you coming at 2 o'clock today, what's your value proposition? What's your point of difference? I'd love to hear from you guys. What's your point of difference? What's the wow? Why would I use you? Give me some feedback. What's your wow? Coldwell Banker is coming at one. You're coming at two. What's the wow? What's your point of difference? Hit me.
A global website that allows to translate multiple languages and also currencies.
So do hookers. Next. Next.
I'll see you later.
Next. Come on, what's your point of difference, team? Give it to me. Yell it out, nice and loud. You're going to clip me for 2.5% or 3% of my coin from a property. What's your point of difference? Why am I going to pick you? Give me some wow, please. What's your point of difference? If you can't tell me, how can you tell me at 2 o'clock? You can't tell me now. How can you tell me at 2 o'clock this afternoon? I want you to really think about that. I think there's so much opportunity in this new world if I can get my clicker to work. Oops. And the question is, sorry, we're going to go back one. For me, the keys to success have changed. So the rules are a bit different. And I ask you, who's the new consumer? And I'm going to say the new consumer, in this case, is me, because I'm going to share a bit about my own personal journey. But before I do, I just want to acknowledge Tandy and Victoria from RE/MAX at Wynnum. Would you please stand? Please. If you guys want to know how to do business well in this organisation or in this industry, please talk to these people. I've just sold my property through them for a significant amount of money in Wynnum at Manly, and the service from these guys was outstanding. Their follow-up with me also as a buyer has been fantastic as well, so please, thank you. Outside of those two people or that team, it's been atrocious. Sorry, well, their office has been outstanding. But in terms of the industry, that mic's not good, is it? Is that any better at the back? Well, let's try that. Okay. So for me, I've just gone through the process of selling a property. And Tandy and Travis and Victoria did an awesome job. Before I had the opportunity to run into them, I went through a really interesting exercise of having three different agents propose to me about how they would market the property. One agent, one of the big name brands around, put to me a marketing proposal that said, 90% of our inquiry comes from online. Is that fair? I don't know whether it is or isn't, but they tell me that 90% of their inquiry comes from online. They asked for a $19,000 marketing budget. Sorry, Ted. They asked for a $19,000 marketing budget. $15,000 of that was in courier mail print. 90% of the inquiry comes from online. $15,000 in print. Bit of a disconnect there somewhere. Agent 2, one of the prestige brands around Brisbane, presented to me. And I said, so I'm a marketing guy. The online world is pretty important to me. Talk to me about how you're going to market the home. This is a prestige brand. No talk of a single property website, no talk of social media, no talk of professional photography, no talk about blogging or any of that sort of content. And a $5,000 marketing budget to sell roughly $1 million home. I thought that was fascinating. Agent 3 didn't respond, by the way, to my request. So that's been fascinating. And in terms, I'm going to talk more about my process and what's gone on as far as a buyer goes. But to me, I just think that's crazy. We're in the marketing business, and I think we're losing the plot. We're outsourcing to other people. Clicker. Who agrees that the consumer's expectations have changed? Do we think our consumer's expectations, Roscoe, have they changed in the last 5 years? What do you think people want more of these days? when the information's out there, there's lots of information. Do we think they want better service, better feedback? Yeah? How are we going about doing that? Talk to me, please. How are we doing? Yes? Okay, right, we'll move on. Who believes they've changed to meet the new consumer? What are you doing? Who's using the online space really, really well? Give us some feedback, guys. Who recognises that guy? Lukey, you'll remember that guy? Tom Hopkins. Who went through the Tom Hopkins School of Training? Okay. And I remember the scripts and dialogue that Tom taught us was, you don't give out the address of the property, did you? You would never give out the address of the property. You try not to give out the address of the price. I reckon the rules have changed. I look at this stuff, I'm a consumer, and I go online to realestate.com.au. What does this tell me? Wynnum West, address available on request. Is there a reason why we do that in the industry, in a world where people want the information now? Who's still doing that stuff? Information, address available on request. Why does the industry do that? Give me some feedback, guys. Why does the industry do that? Generate inquiry? Do we generate inquiry, or do we, can I say, piss people off? Or do we piss people off? I got to tell you, it's pissing me off. I'm just going straight past. In fact, what was fascinating about this particular property, I thought I'd just check it out. And I sent an email to the agent and said, I'd like the address, please. I'm requesting it. Can I have the address? What do you think I've got? An empty inbox. The other thing I'm finding is that I'm seeing properties that have no price range. Or one of the ones I did recently was a search for a unit on the Esplanade at Wynnum, which was I searched 450 to 550, and it came back with a lovely looking unit on the Esplanade at Wynnum. I went, that is awesome. This is really cool. I think I can do this. This is a nice unit for me. I emailed the agent and said, I'd like to arrange an inspection. She said, yes, no problem. They're looking 750. Why are we doing that? When I do a price range search between 450 and 550, it comes back, make an offer. Where are we? Sorry? Okay. Well, I think you obviously need to do that. Because to me, things have changed, and if you can't help me, I think I'm going to find someone that will help me. And what I'm finding, again, is that 41% of agents don't respond to email, and I think that's just crazy. Is there a reason we're doing that 41% of people don't respond to email? This doesn't make it easy. Okay. We've got 59% in here that he'll do. That's good. Okay, thank you for that. So for me, I think it's time for us to stop playing games. And the question I have for you is, are you building relationships with the communication that you're using now? Are you genuinely building relationships with the information, with the email stuff and the stuff you're sending out now? Who's doing targeted email? Who's using your CRMs really, really wisely? Who thinks they've got an awesome... Tell me a bit about your CRM, what you do. Okay. So the thing I'm finding as a consumer, and one of the things that's tough for me, is I'm finding that the industry's starting to taunt me. Excuse me. It's starting to taunt me is that I'm going in there saying I want to buy a property to $700,000, and I'm finding you're sending me stuff for $3 million. Why does that happen? Sorry? Shouldn't be allowed to do it. So for me, recently I was with one of our companies, and the principal of the business said, the principal of the company said, I want you to, his marketing department, I want you to imagine a world where email doesn't exist anymore and snail mail doesn't exist anymore. How would that work for us in our industry if I said to you, Cole, we can't email and we can't snail mail anymore? How would we go about doing that? Is that an opportunity? Because the open rate on email is less than 10%. Snail mail might be relevant if it's good information, but I've got to tell you, most of the time it's bad information. And I see most of us ignoring the massive upsurge in social media, the opportunity around social media. Who's doing social media really well, do you think? Who's having a go? Give us some feedback. Tell us what you're doing. Who's having a play in the social space? Yes, please.
I've increased my likes in 2 weeks by over 100. I went to a training course on different ways to market yourself in social media. And the interesting thing I found was I, as a 42-year-old woman, had no idea what my teenagers were really into, and I thought I was missing a whole generation of buyers. I had never heard of Pinterest and Snapchat and Google Plus and all the other things that they're using now, and I thought I was really savvy because I had a Facebook account. But when I heard that Pinterest is the fastest growing social media in the world, I thought I really need to get on board with what this is all about. It's basically like digital scrapbooking, but you can link it to your Facebook business page. And I've found people like to read about themselves. So if you can put anything on there about properties you've sold, listed, pictures of people that they know, all their friends will tag them, you get a lot more hits and likes with your Facebook account.
Okay, so it's working for you, you're growing some presence, you're growing some brand.
It's also, I think the thing with Facebook is if you do it correctly, it's not you bombarding them with emails. They choose to like your page and to gather the information that you're giving them. So I am really conscious not to drive them crazy sending stuff out constantly, but I put stuff on there that is would be interesting to them. I don't know, Tracy's one of my friends. Is it interesting?
No, I appreciate it. Thank you for that. So you're getting some value for money, and that's good news. Who's having a play in the social space and it's a disaster? Who's going, this is a wank, why are we doing this? This is crazy stuff. Is anyone at that stage going, why are we spending time on this stuff? No? Sorry? Dave Warner's got a problem with Twitter. I think most of us. That's okay, and that's right, you don't have to. All this stuff is absolutely optional. If there's a place if there's a place for you in this sort of business, then use it. If you're not a Twitter person, don't use it. I think it's we'll talk a bit more about that later if we've got some time, about picking the channels that are going to be of value to you, the things that will work and the things that suit your personality. One of the things about social media, by the way, if you suck at real life, you'll quite often suck at social media. And that's not a challenge to you, by the way. But for some people, it ain't meant to be. So one of the things, again, we talked to a lot of businesses about this social media stuff, and they go, yeah, it's what the girl does after she's finished her real work. And I think we can't afford to do that anymore. It's what the girl does after she's finished her real work. And so the business owners here, I'd say to you, please don't adopt that strategy. This is such a vital part of the future of your business that it shouldn't be just, hey, it's what the girl does when she's finished her real work. It should be about, it's a genuine part of the marketing of this particular company. So I'd love you to think about that, and I'd love you to take it a whole lot more seriously than you currently do. I'd like you to tread carefully because it's social media. People buy people. We're in a business where people buy people, and so I'm going to put a couple of examples up here that you might not see at the back, but it's the way that we use some of these tools. So the three screen grabs I've got up on screen, number one is a lady that calls herself Real Estate Lorraine Woodhead. Is her first name really Real Estate? The second one is Craig Johnson, David Dean Real Estate. I don't want to pick on Craig, but this is a social space, guys. So we're putting a real estate name at the end of our business. And this is the last guy at the bottom, Rudy G. Real Estate Guru. Awesome. Rudy G. Real Estate Guru. This is a social space. I pose the question to you. Why when we go online, are we different to what we are in real life? So, Teddy, if I walked into the Whittemore Cell Club on a Friday night and said, great new listing at 37 Smith Street, don't miss it, it's ripping to rail, don't miss my new listing at 37 Smith Street. Mate, I've got an absolute cracker at 37 Smith Street. Cole, don't miss 37 Smith Street. What would they do at the Whittemore Cell Club if I did that on a Friday night at 5 o'clock? Get out of here, you tosser. Is that what they'd say? And so my challenge to you is, if you wouldn't do that at the Whittemore Soil Club or the Camp Hill Bowls Club or where you're from on a Friday night, why do we go and do that in the online space? Why do we start to have these Facebook profiles, I'm saying, maybe different around pages. In fact, it is different around pages. But why do we do it around profiles when we go into this social space trying to flog stuff at people, trying to flog them our wares? Why don't we just adopt that principle of this mic's just not good, is it? It's okay. So why do we go into that social space trying to flog stuff? Who's got a goal in social media? Who's got a goal online? For me, it's pretty simple. For me, it's about getting more people into the funnel, more people in the database. Because for me, if it doesn't relate to putting more dollars in the bank, more people in the database, and building a better relationship with our community, then for me, it's social not working. We'll talk a bit more about social not working later on. That's the goal. So how do we do that? Well, we've got to add value. We've got to be about community. And as I said before, we've got to stop selling. And for me, the new mantra of 2013 and beyond in real estate in any business is make a friend today, do the deal later. Who believes that's the business of 2013? Hard sell's gone. Yes. Can we have a yes? That's what it's about. Make a friend today, do a deal later. Tandy and Victoria are making a friend with me and they'll do the business later. I'm very confident that we'll do some business. Well, I hope we're going to do some business. But it's around the relationship and the trust and respect that I built with these people. And that's the way it's going to be. The future, I think the goal for us all is to be the trusted local advisor. And I can find no better way than social media for us to show ourselves as being the trusted local advisor. Who believes we've got that opportunity? to be in front of our community and show we are the trusted local advisor. How can we show that we're the trusted local advisor? See, for me, I reckon people look at us traditionally, and I'm really sad about this, but I'm one of them. I believe lots of consumers have seen us historically as the guy that turns up every 5 to 7 years, clips them for 10 grand commission, puts the money in the kick, jumps in the Mercedes-Benz, heads off on the horizon and says, thanks for the money, honey, I'll catch you later. Do you think that's a public perception of us as an industry, generally speaking? Generally speaking. That may be unfair because we don't see, the consumer doesn't see all the great stuff we do. But if that's the perception, we need to change that. And for me, social media allows us to do this. It allows us to see that Cole's just part of the community at Annerley, that he's just a good guy. He eats in local restaurants, he shops in the local shops, he dines locally, his kids go to the local schools. And when I can see that side of Cole, I'm going, he's just a cool guy. Does that make sense? So who thinks using some of those sorts of ideas on your Facebook profile slash page would start to endear you better with the community of make a friend today, do a deal later? Let's get rid of the sell. Let's get rid of the hard sell. Let's build the relationships. James, is that a fair thing to say? You're a man, you're a master of stuff in South Australia. I'm honoured to be standing in front of you today, mate. I mean that in the most sincere sense. I saw you spoke maybe 10 years ago at a conference down the coast. It's a...
One of the things we're doing, we're working with restaurants, vineyards, everything else, bringing them into our social media, because every time we go there, we tag, we put on Facebook, so that builds in. Then they put us out for encouraging them, then they tag on, it builds on and on from there. Question for you, being a social media guru.
Not a guru.
We've had it. Okay, social media, whatever. Question is, we've thought about this, and I haven't got an answer. If you were to start a Facebook account for a house when you sell it, run through the sales process, and then when the new people buy it, you give them that Facebook page for that house that continues on, trees planted, this, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So you get away from realestate.com and just have your own ownership of every individual address like that. Is that a possibility?
It's a possibility. So what James was saying, would you set up a Facebook page for each one of the properties that you have? And the answer is yes, you could do that. I'd be more inclined to go and do that actually on a blog. So I'll go and set up 123 Smith Street, sexton.com.au. That's what I do. And I do that because I want to own the data. I want to own the information. So we can go and house all this stuff at Facebook or other places. But what happens when they turn the tap off? What happens when they maybe decide to charge? And it's unlikely they will. But I want to control my data. And so I'd be setting it as a subdomain of your own website called 123 Smith Street, 123smith.sexton.com.au. From an SEO, from a search engine optimization point of view, awesome. Awesome. Because you'll then start to have a page for every property in your community. I'd be thinking about that sort of strategy, for what it's worth, and put some really good content. So, okay. Other things, so create a calendar, are really important for me. One of the things that I see is we get up on a morning and think, oh, geez, I probably should put something in the social space today. I probably should put something on Facebook. What the hell am I going to put on it? Do we find ourselves going, oh, I know I should put something up. What do I put on there? I'll put my new listing. I'd love you to think about creating a calendar that says, Monday's going to be fun Monday. Wednesday's going to be wacky Wednesday. You know, local information Wednesday, and Friday's going to be whatever it is, something about the community. And be really religious about that, because when you've got that stuff programmed in advance, you've got a calendar that says Monday is information about community, Wednesday is something fun, and Friday is about whatever it is. It makes it pretty easy, doesn't it? You know what you're about, you just boom. You can start to stockpile up. You can even, for those business owners in the room, start to go to your team and not have to worry about taking full responsibility for the social media marketing yourself. You can go to the team, Ross, and say, guys, I need you to give us a hand on Monday, you're going to give us a hand on Wednesday, you're going to give us a hand on Friday. And you outsource that to the team, and they know that's part of what they do, and it gets measured at the sales meeting. Because for me, in 2013, it is part of the marketing of the business. Is that true? It's part of the marketing of the business. So it shouldn't be just what the girl does when she's finished her real work. So I'd like you to think about some of that sort of stuff, and we can talk more if we have time around some of what that content would be. But I've got to tell you, please be consistent. Nothing says you're not serious more than going to your Facebook page and finding you haven't posted anything for the last 5 or 6 weeks. It's like, you know, we did a newsletter for 6 weeks, it was good, but then we got busy. So be consistent, commit to it, make sure it happens on an ongoing basis. The other thing I'd love you to think about around engagement around your communities in the social spaces, why does it have to be Facebook.com Remax Advantage? Why couldn't it be Facebook.com We Love Wynnum? Would that be better? Do you think you'd get better engagement around your page if it was Facebook.com We Love Karina? We Love Wynnum? Because I think people are a bit cynical about businesses in the social space. Are you cynical about that? If someone gets you, say, I like my page, you go, yeah, of course I will. You're a friend, you're an uncle, you're a cousin, you're an auntie. Do you really like their page? Do you really want the content? But I challenge you to say, Col, if you did facebook.com, we love Annerley, I love Annerley, our Annerley, or something like that, and posted lots and lots of community content about Annerley, do you reckon you get better buy-in? Yeah? So lovely to think about that concept of putting lots of community stuff in on your Facebook page. I'm going to talk about how you might house some of that stuff and actually share some of that stuff as we go on. Let's try and get Mr. Clicker going for us. So social networking is the other thing we're going to talk about briefly. The question is, are you social networking or are you social networking? And that sort of relates to some of the stuff I was talking about, that behaviour of social offline and social online. There should be no disconnect. The person that you meet in the bar at the Manly Hotel should be the same guy that's speaking up here today. We should be the same people. We shouldn't be outsourcing too much of this stuff to other people with fake profiles or fake stuff. Who's putting listings on Facebook, folks? Who's putting listings up on there? Ooh, okay. So I'm going to preface this and say, personally, I'm okay with it if you're doing it on your company page, because my expectation is you're a real estate agent on your company page, there's going to be listings. And I reserve the right to hide you and just not look at your stuff. Okay, but that's okay. In a page, that's the accepted place. That's how Facebook would like you to do it in a business sense. But in a profile sense, if I join Tandy as a friend on Facebook and she started to pepper me with all her latest listings, what am I going to do? What are you going to do? We're either going to unfriend or hide. That's not what we want to do. That's the last thing we want. So listings for me aren't social, guys. There is a place for them if you choose to do it. And by the way, if you are going to share your listings to Facebook, please share them from your own website. Please don't drive traffic to realestate.com.au. It's crazy. It's crazy. I can't believe the amount of agents that I know on Facebook who go and share their listings and then drive the traffic to realestate.com.au. What else is at realestate.com.au? Are there everyone else's listings? If we're going to drive traffic, baby, let's drive it to our own joint, for me. So for me, the social opportunity is pretty simple. 92% of people trust word of mouth over glossy print. 92% of people trust word of mouth over glossy print. Cole, where's the great place to get a steak at Annerley? Where's the great place to get a steak at Annerley? Junction Park. Cool. Perfect. So that's a referral. So I'm going to believe Cole's word of mouth every day. I'm going to trust what Cole tells me. Because if I go to the Southeast Advertiser and look for a steak joint, what's there going to be? Glossy ads, our steaks are better than Elders, blah, 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 blah. I'm going to trust word of mouth. And so the opportunity for us is huge when we have a social opportunity of people have 92% trust of word of mouth over glossy print. And suddenly I look at the behaviours again. I'm sorry to reiterate the point, but it is the newer and the older generation are connecting online. They're using these tools and they're looking for word of mouth. They're looking for trust. So again, let's stop selling. Let's start connecting. And let's start to build relationships as they probably and possibly should be. And if I look at the cost of it, tell me, folks, what's the cost of using social networks? What's the cost?
Time.
What's the cost of a 30-day ad on realestate.com for a fancy ad like that? $3,666, what is it, $3,665. I even stutter at trying to say that much money. It's unbelievable. So who thinks that we should start to get a bit serious about genuinely building relationships and getting that trust with people? It's a damn sight cheaper. And that high impact of amplified message is huge when you go and get that build and that starts to flow. It's just massive. So, love you to think about it. Sorry. Question? Yeah, no? Okay. So simply it is about the content that we put up there. It's about the information that we share. So be really careful about what it is that you share. And we can take some questions on that as we go if you like. But for me, this is an old mantra in our family that says people don't care how much you know till they know how much you care. And I think that's a really important thing in the social space as well. People don't care how much you know till they know how much you care. Be part of the community. That's the challenge for you. Stop the selling. Start to provide the information. Fact or fiction? People buy people. True or false? True? So then for me, if people buy people, why aren't we treating people like people? I'd love you to just stop now for 2 or 3 minutes at your tables and talk about what's your personal strategy, what's the business strategy to dealing with the new online world. So for 3 minutes, I'd love you just to discuss at the table, how seriously do you take it? What's your personal strategy and what's the company strategy? 3 minutes, and then we're going to come back and get some feedback from you on how you're going to deal with it or how you deal with it now. Thank you. Yep. Yep. Yes, yep.
Got to send that with a rattle attack test and want to. Now what you gonna do? Bad news, misuse, got too much to lose. Give me
me some truth now. Whose side are we on? Whatever you say, turn on the boob tube. I'm in the mood to obey, so lead me astray. And by the way, now, where'd all the good people go? I've been changing channels, I don't see them on the TV shows. Where'd all the good people go? We got heaps and heaps of what we sow.
Share with us what you're going to do or what you're doing, please.
When I sell a property,
yep.
I get the phone of the new buyers and take a photo outside of the sold sign with my buyers.
Cool.
They upload it onto Facebook.
Cool. Okay. So you're getting them to share with their circle of friends, yep. We bought a home off Roxanne.
Yes.
And we're delighted with the service.
And they then tag me in it. So then
awesome.
It's not me promoting myself, it's them promoting me.
Nice. So that's called amplification of conversation. Great stuff. It's using one person to shoot the message out. And no better way to do that in social. Who else we got? Come on, you weren't talking about fishing on the weekend. Or maybe you were. Give us some feedback, guys. What are we talking about? Who's got a personal or company strategy? Yes, James Sexton. Give us a microphone down the front here. Thanks, Eric.
What do we do? We actually run quite a few different pages and different things. We run a Remax Facebook page for our office. We don't put properties on there. All of that happens on the website. We feed them across the website. We actually run a Twitter account, and we run one personally as well. That Twitter's crazy, but what I found Twitter's useful for is you can search on Twitter, and for every business around local and close to you, you watch their tweets, you follow them, then you move, like, retweet them, compliment them, do that. They then come back and follow you, then you feed them across into your Facebook page. It's very, very effective for picking up a lot of business owners, a lot of I suppose community groups. We always get involved in them, follow them. We do a lot of work in the community anyway, so whenever we're doing that, we Facebook that, we Twitter that, and on we go. But we've got the drive behind our whole social media campaign is simply that same thing, trusted advisor, helping the community, doing good things. When we put photos on of our office, it's usually of a social event, it's of kids playing cricket, all this type of stuff.
Nice.
It's a very, we don't put much, we put a bit on about signage, but all that goes on our website. We also run a whole series of different blogs. We run gardening blogs because we're a very big gardening area.
Jeez, you houses. Should be up here doing this.
And we also do, I will be later, and then we also have the gardening blog. We're also just starting a new, trying to get it right. There's your social page, there's your work page, and there's somewhere in between that's the magic millions. That's what you got to get right.
Yep.
We started one about 5 days ago. I haven't got it quite right, called Jamesopedia in the Hills, because of all the knowledge of the hills and trying to fit in there. And it's set up as a community page, but on here, what you said, I've probably got the name wrong, but there's a couple of things we've got to like that. And when you can get everyone else interacting, and a couple of ones I like are Station Photos, which is the fastest growing one in Australia, 20,000 people in 5 months. It's just people posting photos from rural properties. Nothing else happens on there, but massive growth gets involved. The other one is Lost Cairns, is one I saw, that every old property in Cairns, interaction is incredible. That's the type of stuff we're trying to emulate.
Beautiful. So nothing there that I'm hearing about, we sell listings, we sell this. You're just providing information, just engaging with the community.
6 months. Haven't sold a property 6 months, it's tough. Yeah.
I've got one idea that I started doing probably a couple of months ago, and that was every time I get called out for an appraisal, particularly obviously people I don't know, I'll quickly Facebook them, and it's amazing how many times you've got friends in common.
Yep.
And then when you go out there, you can just somehow bring up in conversation and you know, you work out, oh, you know such and such, oh yeah, yeah, we're friends with them, and all of a sudden that puts you a couple of pegs ahead of, you know, your competition.
Really clever stuff. Really clever stuff. So look for that personal connection. Where's the interaction? Most of us connected in some shape, fashion, or form. There's got to be a connection. Who else have we got? What else have we got? Who's got a strategy for the business? Or are we, honestly, are we really just leaving it to the girl to do when she's finished her real work? Is that how we treat the new world of socialomics? Is that what it is? Come on, guys, give us some feedback. Wow. What have we got? Yes, gentlemen down there. At the moment, I'm just seeing the word opportunity flash in front of me. There's so much opportunity.
I found got to make sure you tag people. If you've got photos going up on Facebook or any of those, make sure you tag people in them. Because if you've got 10 people within your office or friends, birthdays, that sort of thing tagged in, their friends see it, and that spread of the likes and the exposure you're getting out of those posts is much, much higher. If you're looking at your end of week graphs for your reach, particularly with Facebook, I found, yeah, if you're tagging, they're much, much higher than just a regular post.
Awesome. Okay, good. So tagging people. Good stuff. Less of a strategy and more of an action or something that I've seen has worked. A couple of people have said to me, so how do you grow likes? How do you get numbers? Think about this very briefly. So who still does that, what I call 10,000 bits of crap? Who does the 10,000 bits of crap in people's letterboxes every month? Is everyone still doing that? We stopped doing that sort of 10,000 bits of crap. I'd love you to think about just a difference, and we've done this. There's about 50 agents that I manage Facebook pages for across Australia, New Zealand and the States. And some of the stuff that we've started doing is to stop doing the 10,000 bits of crap. We're doing this. Just think about this. It's just a beer coaster. It's just the size of a beer coaster. And it simply says, your community is now on Facebook. Come join the local discussion. Facebook.com. We love Wynnum. I love Wynnum. I love Anley, whatever it might be. The rate of likes that we've had on those pages when we run that campaign is massive, far and above anything else that we've ever had when we drop the 10,000 bits of crap. I'm in your street next week providing free appraisals to your customers. Now, if that works for you, by the way, if that stuff still works, keep doing it. But if you're just doing it because the guy down the road does it, it's because what the boss said you should do, question mark. Give it some due diligence and say, is there another way? And I just throw that challenge to you. If you've got a great Facebook page, you want to grow some likes, and you want to be part of the community, it simply says it's a beer coaster. Your community is now on Facebook. Come join the local discussion. Facebook.com. We love Wynnum. Do you think you'd get some traffic? Because for me, it works as this. People are generally a bit passionate about the community or a bit interested in their community. Is that fair to say? So start to host a Facebook page that has some great content about your community. Just a thought. Simply, we go to what's your message. So what's the message? For me, pretty simple. I'd love you to think about this. When I go and Google you, because that is the behaviour of the new consumer. They are Googling you. Yes, would that be right? They Google you to check you out? Question for you to yourself now, and I've got 15 minutes and about 4 hours worth of slides to go through, so really quickly. If I Googled you, would I employ you? If you Googled you, would you employ you? Question mark. Really serious, important stuff. If the consumers out there now go and type it in Ross Bischoff, what do they find? Oh, goodness, Roscoe. But think about it. Would I employ you based on your digital footprint? Would I employ you based on what's there? And if it's not, then think about it. Think about this, is the information that's shared valuable to your community or are you just trying to sell stuff? Is it valuable to your community or are you just trying to flog stuff? We've got to pace through this. You're driving people to the destination, to what I think should be your desired destination, your own website. That's where I want people to go. That's where you should want people to go. Let's not send them off to realestate.com.au and start, you know, I mean, it's crazy. I sit there and look at 1997 when they launched and they were $20 a month. Put your listings on realestate.com, then 165, then 350, then 650. And what is it now a month, by the way? So if you don't start to get serious about driving some traffic to your website, that 3665 that I put before is going to be 5 and 7. So seriously, I'd love you to get serious about getting to it now. And the thing that I challenge, or the challenge that we've got is, I kind of think for the time being, the battle for search is probably over. The battle for search is probably over. I think the consumers that know they're going to go to realestate.com.au to perform the search because that's where 90% of the stock is. You might hold 5% of the stock on your site, but most of it's at realestate.com.au. So I'd say to you, with your website, don't necessarily say, well, we're going to win them on search because I don't think you're going to win them on search. So I think that battle's over. But I reckon we've got that much information, that much knowledge about what's happening in our community that we can, realestate.com can never ever know as much about Wynnum or Sony Bank Hills than you guys will. Is that fair to say? So let's think about what's the content that we can put on our local websites that ranks everyone else, that has great stuff. Where's a great plumber? Where's a great business? Who's got the local coffee? Where's the 2-for-1 steaks on a Tuesday night? What's happening at the local bus interchange down the road? What's happening with the new development up the street? Because for me, if your website gave me that information, I'm probably going to go there on a regular basis, not every 5 to 7 years when I'm in the real estate cycle. Does that make sense? Let's make our websites a hub for great local information, because then you'll get some traffic. But at the moment, I've got to say to you, most of you are letting yourselves down pretty badly. And how does that work? It's pretty simple as this. I talked before about some of the content we put up. I want you to think about this when we start to share stuff on Facebook. For me, all of the content you've got sits at your website, and it gets shared out to Pinterest or Facebook or LinkedIn or Google or Twitter or wherever you want it to go. But it's the hub. So if you're going to share stuff on Facebook, James, you asked the question before about owning content. I want the content sitting on sexton.com.au. Let's throw it out there in Facebook and Twitter and wherever else, and then someone bites on it, brings them back home. Make sense? So that's called hub and spoke. You want to talk more about hub and spoke? Happy to talk about that later. Any questions on that so far? I think I've got 7 minutes to put in 3.5 hours with the slides. Okay, so simply what's your message to me? Community content is king. If it's about your community, people love it. Your community loves it, and Google loves it. Who thinks SEO is important, search engine optimization? Who thinks it's important to be found on Google? Yeah? What are you doing about it? Here's a question for you. Look at some numbers. Where do you rank? Give me an honesty test. If you don't want to do it with yourself now, write it down. We'll make these slides available. Where do you rank when I search your name real estate? Are you on page one? Give me a show. If I search your name real estate, are you on page one? 87% of consumers don't go past page one. 13% do. We're not bad on maths. So if you're not on page one, are you off the shopping list? Pretty much. What about when I search for your name suburb? Tandy Gill Wynnum. Where do you rank? Page one, or are you somewhere else? Or to realestate.com, own your name and on that space. Really important to start to think about it. When I search your name, do I find you or do I find someone else? Do I find the real Ross Bischoff or do I find a, you know, chick magnet athlete from, it's probably the same guy. And when I search for suburb name real estate, and the stats are there are 3.84 million searches per month done in Australia on Google using suburb name real estate suburb name. That's the behaviour. That's what consumers do in Australia. 3.84 million searches per month. Suburb name real estate. If you're not on that shopping list, if you're not page one for those search results when people search Wynnum real estate Wynnum, are you in trouble? I suspect you are. That's the new consumer. So please, don't treat this, don't give this to the girl to do when she's finished real work. This is an important part of your business. Righto, what's your wow? Who's doing video, by the way? For me, what's the wow? I asked before, what's your point of difference? Some doing video. Who's not doing video? Honesty test, who's not doing video on a regular basis with all your listings and stuff? Why? Feedback why, please. A couple of things, just would like you to show these. And again, time, I'm not going to play them all. This is a lady called Ann Jones and another lady called Marguerite. They're Tacoma Real Estate in the USA. Is this going to load? And no audio. So who's good at miming? And Bardo. I'd love you to check them out. Tacoma Real Estate, Ann Jones and Marguerite. They do videos every week. You can see they're just fun girls. They just share good information. They talk about the buying process, the selling process, stuff that works. They answer people's questions. We'll move on. Next guy, Razzie. This one is, who have we got? We're going to keep moving on. So for me, what can we use video for? Give us some feedback. What can we use video for, guys? What can we use video for? Sell properties. Convey information to our community. Build ourselves as a decent person. For me, this is the challenge, and I'm sorry we didn't get to see Anne and Marguerite, but I'm absolutely convinced in my mind, if you watch 2 minutes of them on video, you'd buy them. The decision would be made before you even got to meet them, you'd buy them. Who'd like to have that luxury? Gentlemen, before we've been talking about common connections. Who thinks that'd be nice when you just looked at someone looked at your video and went, wow, she's a cool dude, he's a good looking guy, he's a smart guy, they know their stuff. Half the battle can be won. What's the barrier? Tell me, is it cost? I want to go back.
Hi, I'm Jason Haber of Rubicon Property, and welcome to the Barclay Mansion at 5 East 78th Street on Manhattan's Upper East Side. You know, this block is one of the most beautiful in all of New York, and today we're excited to have you here in this apartment, apartment 2-3, in this.
So I'm obviously the technology guy. Okay. So from what you saw of that so far, does that look like a half-decent video? What do you reckon, again, you've only seen 15 or 20 seconds of it, what do you reckon something like that would cost to produce? Give us some feedback. 300, 550, something like that, okay.
What about majestic Beaux-Arts masterpiece. The townhouse itself was built around 100 years ago and
We're going to move on. What have I told you that was shot on an iPad? What have I said that was shot on an iPad, edited on an iPad, and took 9 minutes to do? What have I told you that was free? What have I told you that you could go to a website called videolicious.com, videolicious.com, and download the app to your iPad or your iPhone? Can we kill the audio on that, please? Thank you. What have I told you could have that for free? It's an iPad app. It's not for any other devices. So it's not Android or Samsung Galaxies. It's simply just an iPhone, an iPad app. Would that be pretty cool to produce something like that? Nice voiceover, nice transitions, fairly easy to do for free. For me, that takes out the barrier of cost. 9 minutes isn't a lot of time. Whose competitors do video on a regular basis? Who are your competitors do video on a regular basis and are starting to beat you? No? So if they're not doing it and you're not doing it, who's going to do it first? Up to you guys, I guess. So moving on. So for me, I'd love you to think about some new goals. I'd love you to think about using video. I'd like you to think about whether you can do market updates, maybe 60 seconds with Ross Bischoff once a month. Just a quick little video where you share that with your database. It just goes out. Ross go talking about the market. Real easy to do. Set up the iPhone in your office. Ross turns up. He talks to 5 points. He keeps it to 60 seconds. Bang, it gets uploaded to YouTube and you send it out there. And if people say that you don't know how to do it, go and get a coach and find out how to do it. Smartest thing you can ever do if you want to treat business seriously. Frequently asked questions. I'd love you to think about what are the frequently asked questions that come to your business on a regular basis? What are the things that people ask your sales team or even your property management team? The real people that ask your property management team, what do they ask? They'd be saying, you know, where's my 2 weeks rent gone when I first paid? How do I get my bond back? How do I make an application? How do I this? How do I that? Does that happen? Do we get frequently asked questions? Why wouldn't we take the time to go and do 5, 10, 15 videos that answer those questions, stick them up on our website and stick them up on YouTube, the world's number two search engine, and get found? Because think about me, if I'm an absentee landlord in Kununurra, Western Australia, and I want to check out who's going to manage my property, want to find an agent in Sunnybank Hills, and I see that sort of stuff, I think that's pretty cool. Cost is nothing, it's just time and dedication to being serious about it. So I'd love you to think about some of that sort of stuff. I'd love you to think about putting up a personal profile, 1 or 2 minutes that just tells your story. People by people, we talked about it before. But all I see when I go to your websites is just a photo. I don't know whether you're a shonk, shady, or a good guy. Let me see a bit more about your personality, really important in a visual world. Let's talk about our neighbourhoods. If you want some examples of good people to follow on YouTube, Go and search out a guy called Raziel Unger, R-A-Z-I-E-L, Raziel Unger. He's in San Francisco. He runs a website called Burlingame Buzz. He does 2 or 3 videos a week, which are about his community, about his properties, and he just owns Burlingame. He just owns the space. So check out Raziel Unger and subscribe to his YouTube channel. You'll find some great stuff. It's worth seeing. It'll certainly give you some tips for other things you can do with video. I mean, also check out a guy called Brian Copeland in Nashville. Brian is a master. Brian entered the real estate business in Nashville 5 years ago. Wanted a point of difference because everyone else in Nashville was just doing real estate. He said, I'm going to do video. I'm going to be the video guy. Now he's the market leader in his neighbourhood in Nashville. He's just a video guy. People come and say, Brian, we want you to do a video. Oh, well, when I'm ready. So he owns the market, but his point of difference has been video. Now he spent a few bucks, but he owns the space and he knows what he's doing. So what's your point of difference? Could video be your point of difference? Could you be the video guy, the video gal? Love you to think about what your point of difference is going to be. It's very quickly. Challenge around this stuff is this. Don't be a digital magpie. Don't be the digital magpie. Digital magpies go and collect everything. We'll have a bit of this and a bit of this. They take it all back to the nest. They try and do it all. Don't be that guy. Don't be that girl. Pick two things. I'm going to blog. I'm going to Facebook. I'm going to tweet. I'm going to YouTube. Whatever it is, but pick two and be really good at them. Because if you try and do, I'm going to do Facebook and Twitter and YouTube and Pinterest, you know, you just won't ever list and sell some real estate. And that's when you start to do social not working. Yeah? Make sense? So pick two. Don't be the magpie. As I say, you know, there's a definition that says average is best of the worst cream of the crap. Don't be average. Be really good at two and be awesome at it. Don't be cream of the crap. All right, we're trying to wind up as quick as we can. So for me, really simply, it's not a fad, so what's your plan? For me, it's this. One, I'd like you to apply a resource. Oops, let's go back. I'd like you to apply a resource. For me, resources are three things. Time, people, money. Time, people, money. So apply a resource to that side of the business. Get serious and say, we're going to put some time, 15 to 20 minutes a day is what we're going to do on social networking or websites, whatever the important part is to you. People, let's get a dedicated person, make them accountable and responsible, put it as part of their action plan and measure it each week. They sit down as part of the sales meeting and say, what are we doing? How's it going? What are the likes? What are the this? What's the followers? What's the ranking? You decide what the measurements of success are. And put some money. If you've got a marketing budget, please just take 10 to 15% of what you're spending on print or you're wasting on print or on realestate.com and put it towards some of this stuff. Be worthwhile. Give it some, be serious. Number two, create a strategy. Create a strategy. Decide exactly what it is for your social, your website, and your footprint. Create a strategy. What do we want to achieve? Put it in place. Determine the content. Decide what it is that you're going to put out there and put a calendar in place. So you know what you've got to do. It's not, I haven't done it for 6 weeks, I'll do it in seven. Have a calendar. Commit to it. Monday, Wednesday, Friday. I'm going to do it and it's going to happen. Win, lose, or draw. With some of the stuff that's around these days, you can actually back it up. So if you're sitting at home on a Sunday, you can actually put 2 or 3 months worth of content out there. Just program it in advance and then walk away and not touch it for another 2 or 3 months. So build some content. That's pretty simple. And set a go date. Again, really important for me. Decide a date you're going to make it happen and then spend the next two or three weeks leading up to it getting the content, getting the page right. Because there's no point going out and advertising and saying, come and like my page if there's nothing on it. So let's get some content on the bloody thing first. Let's make it look good and then let's set a go date and then go to market. Make it happen. Last one here. Grow your social community. So people say, how do I grow likes? Well, it's through mail outs. It's through contests. It's through Facebook ads. Who's used Facebook ads, by the way? Anyone used those? Yeah, used them? Successful? Pretty cool. Quick thing on Facebook ads. I'm really conscious of time, Ellie. When you log on to Facebook, there's ads that come down the right-hand side of the page. Anyone see those? The ads that come down the right-hand side. So for me, they're generally for baldness cures, weight loss cures, and little blue pills. Don't know what that means. The other lady I work with, Kim, she's recently had a baby, so she gets nappies and baby stuff and baby showers and all that sort of stuff. So the ability to target in on a demographic and a geographic is awesome if you want to start building some likes. So look at Facebook ads. Look at some rewards. For me, there's no more date nights. I call date nights this. I generally hear from a real estate agent, no disrespect, again, Tandy and Victoria do awesome. But most of the time, I just hear once a year. You know, congratulations, been in your house a year. For me, no more date nights. I don't want to be date night once a year. I want you to seduce me, whoo, Roscoe, all year. I want you to give me information all year. I want you to build a relationship with me all year. That, to me, is really important. And then measure it, tweak it, be consistent, be on message, and remember, people buy people. They don't come to the social space to get sold. So, summarise, change, it's just there. It's just change is imminent. It's going to happen. Number two, put together a digital strategy. Understand what you're going to do. If you haven't got someone that can do it for you, give me a call. Give someone else a call. It's like you get an auction coach to help you with auctions. Get a tech coach to give you a hand with some of the tech and online stuff. Identify your markets. Drive people to where you want them to be and give them what they want when they get there. So no surprises. If I like your Facebook page and it's about your community, don't then start peppering it with real estate stuff. Find someone to give you a hand because I believe you can have a digital wow. You can. Most important is like Nike do, JDI. Just do it. And for me, I think that's about it. Last message is this. I don't think real estate agents were replaced by technology, but I absolutely believe that real estate agents were replaced by real estate agents who effectively use technology. The challenge is to you whether you're going to effectively use technology and embrace it or whether you're going to ignore it. If you want to talk to me, you'll find me at thatpeterbrewer.com is my website, or you can give me a bell on the phone. The slides will be available. Hope you had some value. If you've got some questions, happy to take them. Thank you.